devil will not have the final say over your life in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
I said the devil will not have the final say over your life in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
He won't have the final say in your family in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's give God praise.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's give Him glory. Just thank Him where you are sitting. Just magnify His holy name. Thank Him. He has given you the privilege to be in His presence today. The devil's plan and the devil's wish is for you to be in the mortuary. But you are in the sanctuary praising God. So why don't you exalt Him? Why don't you lift Him up? Why don't you lift Him up? Why don't you lift Him up? Exalt His holy name. Give Him thanks. Give Him thanks. Give Him thanks. Magnify His name. Him alone is worthy to be praised. Exalt Him. Exalt Him. Exalt Him. He's worthy to be praised. Thank you, Jesus. Father, as we look into your word today, we pray that your spirit will breathe afresh upon us in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
We open our eyes of understanding to behold wondrous things out of your law today in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
The Bible said concerning Joseph, and he said, when his word came, the king sent for him and he loosed him. Lord, as we are seated here individually today, let our word come in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
The word that will loose us from any kind of bondage, let it come today in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
After that encounter, there was no record that says that Joseph ever went back into the prison. I therefore decree today that our victory shall be permanent in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
From that encounter, he set him in his place. He became a special advisor unto the king. I pray today that in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, as the word of God is coming our way, He will create our place for us in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
No matter the level of decadence, the hand of God will restore us in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Blessed be your holy name.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
I want to take this opportunity to welcome our sister into our midst. You're worshiping with us for the very first time. Let's give a hand for Jesus. Set apart, that the heart of God will rest upon this material. The breath of the Lord will be upon it in the mighty name of Jesus. As they are collecting it, the Holy Spirit will arrest them and bring them to the kingdom of God in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. And therefore, in the name of the Father,
amen,
the name of the Son,
amen,
the name of the Holy Spirit,
amen,
we dedicate this material in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together for Jesus. Let's stand for Jesus, for the King of Kings, for the Lord of Lords, for the King of I am. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We put people into today's teaching. Our time is fast spent. And like we've always been saying, whatever opportunity we have, let's try to listen attentively. And if we have time, let's go back to the teachings on the website and listen to them. You know, scientists, they said average human being have to hear something 46 minimum times before it can stick in your memory. Hello? You hear it 46 times. And that's why most of the serious language courses, if you look at even in the military, if you want to invade a country and they want to go and spy them, they send people to go and learn the language. It takes them average of that time to really learn to be fluent in the language. And we know that how many weeks do we have in a year?
52.
52. Which means if you come to Sunday, that means if you didn't miss any Sunday, you only had maybe 52 hours. But it's not enough. Hallelujah. I've never seen a first class student that only goes to class once a while. So we have to create time. Hello?
Time.
If you want to be first class Christian, that your life will be reflecting the glory of God, you have to create time. Because Bible says, faith comes by hearing. And hearing what? By the word of God. It comes by hearing. So we hear again and again. So if it's not 52 times, I mean 2 weeks, not enough. For example, this year, we're going to be taking the redemptive benefits one by one. We started in February now. We've taken power. Next month, we go to another one. Next month, we go to another one. We have how many months? We can't finish it. We have only 4 months here. I mean, 4 weeks in this month, for example. We can't finish power. Hello?
Hi.
Look at my notes. If I say, a lot of time I discover that we just take like a small part of it. So let's take time. We will not be deceived by the enemy in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Religiosity does not equal to reality. So let's take time and listen and get blessed in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And so we started the month. Our prophetic focus says empower to be what? To be a witness. Hallelujah.
Amen.
To be a witness. And we said that the word witness is a legal term. It's like you witness something or something happened, an occurrence or an incident happened in your presence, empowered by the Holy Ghost to be a witness, according to Acts 1:8. He said that word witness, when Jesus told them that you're going to receive power, he said, don't rush. I'm giving you the responsibility. But don't rush to go and carry out the responsibility because you need the ability to carry out the responsibility. Hello? I'm giving you the authority. You need the empowerment. Hello? You know, authority without empowerment makes you a toy. A puppet. Imagine if somebody says, I win the election. Okay, yes, you are jubilating. But they say you are just the president, you don't have control over the army. Then you are afraid. Well, they can remove you. Hello? That's why they do coup d'etat. Because they have the power. You have the authority, they have the power, so they remove you. So authority without empowerment makes you a toy. What is Yoruba calling? Is it Eshimu or Janu? You know, have you ever seen the picture of a horse in the paper? Can he jump? Have you ever seen a picture of a dog? An angry dog. He's a German Shepherd. Which Mr. Mugabe, that dog that wrote well and said, that's a very crazy dog. If you see in the newspaper like this, can he bite you? He can't. Hey, so when you are a Christian and you don't have power, you are like that. You are not a threat to the devil. Huh. But as for you, you'll be empowered to go to the kingdom of God and slap them here and there. while it comes, people who are dead. But they have never born that dead that will say, it's Jesus. Okay, about that one. Even people who are angry with him, people who didn't like him, they've never addressed him as late Jesus. It doesn't even sound nice, you know. There's nothing like late Jesus, because he's alive. So he said, I'm going to empower you. You will go to the world. You will demonstrate to every man that I am alive. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
So we look at the purpose of power. That you have power to fulfill your destiny. Because when you have your phone, no matter how expensive that phone is, even if it's iPhone 20, without power, without battery, can you use to call? Except you're acting drama. Hello, 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 hello. They will just be laughing at you. Because you can't call nobody without power, sir. Hello? So we look at the purpose of power, and the second week, what do we look at? We look at the how to go to get that power, because it could be so frustrating if you know what you want or you don't know how to get there. That's why the Bible says that the labor of the foolish wearieth them, because it does not know how. Hello? You want food. Hello? But you don't know how to do it. You don't know how to get at it. Then you begin to struggle, you begin to sweat. When you see a man sweating, something is missing, information. Like one of our fathers said, he said there is no mountain anywhere. Everyone's ignorance is mountain. That's the truth. And like I've given that example, in the old time when you are digging well in Africa, you are using digger and you are sweating. And as you continue to dig and you get to a hard rock, what do? Say, it's a bad ground. You abandon it, cover it, go to another place. You are ignorant, you don't know what to do. But somebody that has dynamite or that has access to it, he will just drill it and load dynamite there and boom, he will blast it off. Hallelujah.
Amen.
To somebody, it is impossible to drill a well when there is stone there. Hello?
Hi.
To somebody, they say, this tree. It's too big, you can't break it down. But if you know how to operate the bulldozer, you just go there, you bend your blade, cut the root here, you push it, the thing will fall. So if you see yourself sweating to get at results concerning anything, it means you don't know enough, you don't have a secret. May God help us to maximize the teaching. So we started looking at the journey to empowerment. And last week, we look at the first factor, that without adequate or genuine desperation, the power of God cannot fall upon you. They were not sitting on there, I mean, on the day of Pentecost and saying, okay, hello guys, please give me the remote control, change it to CNN. What's there? Just watching TV. No. They were waiting upon the Lord, praying, singing songs, worshiping him. And Bible said, when it was time, the Spirit of God came. Powerfully. Hello? The one that wrote it, Luke, the doctor, when he was writing it, he said, it was like a great mighty wind. Because at that time, the largest noise that they were used to was that kind of great mighty wind. You can liken it to, you know, when an aeroplane is... You know, just moving my side. And, but the Holy Spirit came with power to his place. But they were not just waiting and saying, okay, no. They were waiting with all seriousness. And so we say that if the power of God wants to come upon your life, you have to wait. That's what the Bible says, that those that wait upon the Lord, that word wait means to wind yourself around the Lord, just like a rope, just like this one. It's an action word. Hello? Many people, they think they are waiting, but they are wasting. Hello? Waiting does not equal to just sitting there and say, okay, it's going to come. No. It won't come that way. You know, we have this deceptive word we used to say, with time, it will change. Nothing changes with time. Hello? Let me explain it to you this way. Take a man. He has never learned Swedish language. You lock him up in a place. Yes, and he's not exposed to a place where he will hear Swedish. Lock him up in a place for 100 years. Will he be able to speak Swedish? He won't speak nothing. Time will pass, but nothing will change. Hello? Until you take corresponding step to get to pursue what you want, nothing will come. Hello? There are steps that we need to take, and one of the first steps is to have desperation, to create desperation in your heart. That, Lord, without this power, I can't do it. Moses said, Lord, I'm not going anywhere. We are not going nowhere until your son, until you go with us. It means that until you empower me. Hello? Hi. Until you empower me, I can't go nowhere because I will be a casualty. Hallelujah to Jesus.
Amen.
I will be a casualty that way. If I'm not adequately empowered, we're talking of adequate empowerment, not just empowerment. Because if you can charge your phone, some phone is just 20% charge. Some phone is 100% charge. Some phone is 60% charge. You need to be loaded with adequate power. You are trying to pull a trailer. If the engine, if the trailer is designed to be pulled at maybe 2 horsepower, and your car is maybe 1 horsepower, you will be sweating. Hello? So we need adequate empowerment. And today, as we quickly round up the session, we want to look at other factors that we need to consider to be empowered. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Remember that the church is loaded with enough power, being the body and the representative of Christ, to take care of all the challenges that can arise in this entire world. And that's why, when if you take the church out of this earth, it will be a terrible place to live in. Because the Bible says we are the salt of the earth. What the responsibility of the salt? To add taste and to preserve. You know, that time they didn't have anything called fridge. So anything they want to preserve, they preserve with salt. So when you take the church out of the earth, because the church is the habitation or the temple of the Holy Spirit, take the Holy Spirit from a place, it's hell that is left. That's what makes hell a terrible place. Because the glory of God will not be there. It's a lonely place. Thank you, Jesus. So the Lord loaded his church with power, and we are loaded with enough power to take care of this entire earth. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Let's go to the Word of God. Ephesians chapter 3. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's just jump to verse 10 to make it fast. So, Ephesians 3:10. Chapter 3 and verse 10 said, let me read for you. I said, to the intent, are we there?
Yes, sir.
He said, to the intent, what is intent? The plan. You know, intent came from the word intention, or your plan. He said, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. Manifold wisdom of God, but many-sided wisdom of God. Diverse wisdom of God. Bible is saying that he put his church in place. The intention of God is to make known to the principalities. Who are the principalities? Demons. The devils. He said, principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known the manifold wisdom of God. So God put his church in place to demonstrate his greatness through his church. Hello?
Hi.
He put his church in play to demonstrate to the devil. Hello?
Hi.
That's why when the devil is knocking your head, God is saying, I've empowered you to be in charge. Do you know that in the Garden of Eden, the devil didn't get crushed there? He had to negotiate his way in. He didn't go in as a robber and say, okay, I have AK-47. Adam, lift up your head, lift your hands, close your eyes. Eve, lift up your hands, well, pick that fruit. If you don't pick it, I will blast your head. He couldn't do that. He didn't have that power. That was why he had to deceive them. He knew he didn't have that power. No, man was given authority over the air. Everything was in charge, sir. That was why the devil had to sneak in. Do you know the con men or the scammers, they want to steal people's money with card? Did they tell me to you that I want to steal your 20,000 from your account right now? Give me your password. Will you give them? Even if they won't do that. But by the time they send a nice mail to you that say, okay, oh, I'm calling from social bank and I want to. See, they con you. They deceive you to give it to them. Because you know that you cannot
twist on me and twist you to get it. The devil does not have that power, sir. He doesn't have the capacity. No! He is a fallen angel. Miserable angel that is looking for a place of rest. Like I told you last week, I said he lost his apartment. And unfortunately, his apartment was not vacant. I said he can go back there to check. Bible said there was no more place for him. So God erased. You know when God erased something, when the Most High erased something, can you find it again? You can't find it. So God erased his place completely. God removed his habitation. And that was where he goes around looking for a place to stay. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
so it's a miserable spirit. The devil is a miserable spirit. And that's why he's always looking. You know why? Let me tell you a secret. Do you know that according to the word of God, from the book of Genesis, the only being that has authority to do things here or now is a spirit that has body. That's a human being. That's why when a man dies, he can't stay here anymore. He has to leave. Yeah, it's not negotiable. He has to leave. Not even the devil could do anything here on earth. That's why he needed the body of a snake. He can't, sir. You see, let me expose his weakness to you. If you understand his weakness, he's a toy in the man that you slap him every time here and there. That's why I cannot tell you. If you see a man, a Christian, crying because of a witch, you pity him. He's a victim of ignorance. Because a witch is a man or woman that is possessed by a fallen angel. A fallen angel doesn't have power. Bible said you seated in heavenly realm in Christ Jesus, far above principalities and power. Hello? Just above? No, not just above. Far. So you can slap a devil, you can slap a witch and still spit on his face. He can't do you not. He doesn't have the capacity. He only takes advantage of your ignorance. You are liberated to be the maximum of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Every devil that is trying to humiliate your family will be roasted by the fire of the Holy Ghost in the maximum of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Brethren, you can have the confidence to call your family and say, every devil, every witch must give way. You know, they don't show me one thing, one time. When I was reading the one book, it was the authority of the believer. And he showed me the vision of a computer. And he said, type something. That's in the speed. I typed it. He said, I highlighted it. He said, delete. I said, delete. I said, yes. He said, then the computer asked me, do you want to delete? I said, yes. He said, that's the way. He said, when you delete the hand of the devil from your life, it's as easy as that. You know, from that day, I was liberated forever. I cannot beg you, devil, sir. Beg you for what? Who bought you? They don't have the capacity. Let me show you another picture. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's go to Ephesians. You know, when we paint the picture of the scripture, you are able to understand the reality. Ephesians chapter. Let's go to chapter 1. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Ephesians 1, let's jump to verse 19. He said, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us world?
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Who believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ, when he raised him from the dead, and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. Hello? Verse 21. Together.
Far
above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. He said, he raised him far above. Not just above, but far above. He said in verse 22. And has put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. So he raised him far above principalities, above power, and the church is in him. Hello?
So the devil is far below under your feet. The only way he can through which he can humiliate you is when you don't know. Hallelujah to Jesus. Amen. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 12. Revelation 12:12. He said, rejoice, therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. I think somebody will rejoice. Are you dwelling in heaven? Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Rejoice. That means rejoice means re. You know, the word re is means to do something again. So rejoice, rejoice. Let the joy fill your heart again and again. Why? He said, because you dwell in heaven. He now said, woe. Say woe.
Woe.
Woe means crushed. He said, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. Why? For the devil is come down unto them, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. So when he lost his place in the heavenly realm, he come to the earth. But when you are saved, when you are born again, the day you receive Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you have been translated from the earthly realm to the heavenly realm.
Amen.
You don't get that? Remember when man fell? God pronounced the judgment. And he said to the man, he said, dust art thou, isn't it? He said, dust art thou. You return to the dust. Why? When the Spirit of God checked out of the man, he became dust. Hello? And he spoke to the devil. He said, what will be your food? He said, you are going to be creeping under on your belly, and dust shall thou eat. So any man that is not born again is dust, and is a food, free food for the devil. Do you get the picture now? Remember, he spoke to the fallen man, said, now, because you are fallen, the Spirit of God has checked out of you, you are ordinary dust. And he said to the devil, now, your food is dust. So any man that's not born again is abiding in the earthly realm, and the devil can eat him at any time. It's like a poultry bird that there's somebody is keeping. He can kill him at any time. But you are not in that category anymore. Because you are born again, hallelujah to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You are dwelling in the heavenly realm, far above principalities and power, in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
So the devil does not have legal right to feed on you. He doesn't have legal right to feed on your health. He doesn't have legal right to feed on your finances. He doesn't have legal right to feed on your family. He cannot scatter your home because he doesn't have the power.
Amen.
That's why the Bible says that for whatever God has joined together, let no man put asunder. There is no devil. I will say, okay, you want to tear your family. As he's thinking it, angel will be knocking him on the head. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus
Christ.
Thank you, Lord. So what are we trying to paint? We are trying to paint the picture that in Christ Jesus, you are in the position of authority. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's see another one. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. We have to read that one. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 6. 10 through to 18. We have to read that one. He said, are we there?
No.
Yes, sir.
Ephesians 6, 10. He said, finally, my brethren, be strong. Say, be strong.
Be strong.
Hallelujah. Be strong. You know, some people, they look very small in stature, but they are bigger than you think.
Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah. They are bigger. You know, no matter how big the body builder is, if ordinary fluid locks him down, fluid. You see? He's not big for nothing. He doesn't have the power. But so you can see a tiny boy that knows his position in Christ Jesus. That will speak of the devil. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because in Christ Jesus, he looks like dwelling in you. He said, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Who is in you? The Holy Spirit, the Most High, is dwelling in you. Who is in the world? A fallen angel. You know, a dissident soldier, anytime, is always in, what do you call it? People that are running around. Is it vagabond? Yeah, it's vagabond. Is it vagabond? Yeah, he's always afraid of everything. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord. He devil is a dissident soldier. Because every time he's saying, he sees one angel. He picked grace. You know why God wanted to deal with him? God didn't fight him and say, he sent an angel. He said, Michael, come and deal with him. Hello? Help me from Michael. He said, Michael, go and deal. It was even Michael that dealt with him. Thank you, Jesus Christ. He said, finally, my brethren, strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. He said, put on the whole armor of God. That means put on your own, your gadgets. Don't go to the world with slippers. Do you? And say, okay, I want to go and fight tomorrow. I go with slippers. No. He said, put on your uniform. Put on your gadget. He said, put on the whole armor of God, that he may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. You know, the word something wise comes from deception. That is the strength of the devil. And he said, he could not force himself into the garden. He had to deceive them. That's why God said, protect yourself against the wiles, against the deception. For example, he knows that this man, in Christ Jesus, he has the destiny to be rich. Because the Bible says that cursed is everyone that hanging on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the gate, isn't it? He said, you know, opportunity has come. See that money now, that you can be rich. But that's a word, that's a deception. Yeah, but if you know the truth, say, shut up. In Christ Jesus, it is written, cause is everyone that hanging on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon it. So God gave back to me to be rich. Hello? You tell some people, say, you know, in your family, remember, your great grandfather, he died when he was 50 something. Remember, even your uncle that died, look at you. You are moving nearly 50 now. You're getting there in the program. You can see your head. Maybe you can die at any time. Better go to the lawyer and make a will. Say, shut up, devil. Hello? Right. So be equipped with the truth. Because as the Bible said, against the wise, the deception, the lies, that's the meaning. The word wise is lies. He deceived people. Remember what, when he went to the garden, what did he do? He didn't say, if you don't leave open the door, I will blast you. No. He deceived them. He said, if you eat the fruit, you are going to be like God. You are already created in the image of God. In fact, Jesus said, he said to them, ye are God. Hello?
Hi.
So he was already telling them what they are already becoming, what they have already become. They are in Christ Jesus. I mean, in God, they are already created in the image of God. Remember in the book of Isaiah, Bible talking about the devil, he said he wants to be like the Most High. And he knew that the only being created in the image of God is human being. So if he could get human being to himself, then he would have that creative ability. Because there's only God, it's only God and human being that have the creative ability. If they can't create, you don't have that nature. You don't have that capacity. So the devil is eyeing you. Like my wife said when she was sharing testimony, she said, show you are. So for people is this, they are eyeing you. That's the truth. You may think that you are below. No, that's not true. There are some people that are still saying, I wish I could be like this man. Hello? So keep God praise for where you are. There are people that are still saying, I wish I could be like this man. So the devil is eyeing your place. He wants to take your place. And you know the only way he can get access to you is to deceive you. You will not be deceived, the maximum of Jesus.
Amen.
I said, you will not be deceived, the maximum of Jesus.
Amen.
He deceived Reuben. Reuben being the firstborn of his father. He said, you know, you are the firstborn. You can start taking the position of the father right now. Start sleeping with your father's wife. And he went into his father's bed. And the father looked at him. The father, the wedding was about to pack up. He said, Reuben, you are my firstborn. The excellency of my power. You are supposed to be His Excellency, but you will never accept. He deceived him. The devil deceived him into taking. He couldn't wait. Already you are the firstborn. Where the man lives, all his estate, what does actually belong to you? Why will you run after his wife? Hallelujah.
Yes.
He's a deceiver. He told Esau, he said, Esau, what is it? This thing, just don't worry, negotiate him. Eat the food. He ate the food and he lost out. You will not be deceived by the name of Jesus Christ. So he said, put on the whole armor of God that he may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, why? Verse 12. He said, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Hallelujah.
Yes.
But against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. He said, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. So put on your uniform, that ye may be able to withstand the evil day. And having done all to stand, he said, stand up in your, put on your garments. Put on your military uniform and stand up. He said in verse 14, he said, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth. That means, and having the, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. Thank you, Jesus Christ. So he said, put on your belt of truth. You know, as a military man, you know, their gadgets. He said, wear your belt. Put on your breastplate to protect your chest. And your feet. Show the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, cover your head. You know, when you're cycling, put the helmet in case you fall. He said, cover your head with the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So he said, put on the whole armor. Put on the whole armor. Put on your complete uniform. Don't leave anyone. Imagine a soldier going to war without shoe. He's in trouble. Imagine a soldier. He doesn't have a sword. A swordless soldier. Ah! Pastor Boko will deal with him. Only Boko will teach him lesson. Thank you, Jesus Christ.
You,
so he said, we go there. But now, look at the picture the Bible is trying to tell you. You are above principalities and power. You are loaded with that the armor. But your enemy is lying on the floor. Who has more power? It's you! You are at the place of advantage, sir. The only way through which he can get you is to trick you into saying, okay, you know, that sword you are holding is a fake, it's a plastic, it can't work. Give me, let me check it. You give him and you cut your hand. Did you get it? He doesn't have the capacity. He's far below. No matter how strong his soldier is, if they have tied his hand and he's lying on the floor, how easy is it for him to be someone that is standing, to slap someone that is standing? Hello? Unless it's James Bond. And James Bond on his fake. He's trick. Hello? So he doesn't have it, sir. He doesn't have it. That's why when the devil is slapping you, Jesus is saying, I paid the price for you to have the sword. I paid the price for you to have the helmet of salvation. You know salvation, I mean, you're born again. I paid the price for you to have the belt of the truth. The truth is the word of God. I paid the price. The devil can't be humiliating you. No! He doesn't have the capacity. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So have this one. Let this picture stay in your mind. You walk with that understanding. You know what? When you discover whom you are, I'm telling you, every inferiority complex will disappear to match. You know, you can give somebody and put in a position of authority. If he doesn't understand it, he will still be living as if he didn't have it at all. Hello? He will still be living like that. You give some people, because he doesn't have the ability to manage. Give him $1 million, $1 million, $1 million in the currency. He can't manage it. He lacks the capacity. But as for you, he created you with that ability. Now, as you try to round up, what are those factors that we need to put into place? Remember, we said that you have to desperately search for the power of God. Number two, now you have to consider the love factor. You must walk in love to possess the power of God. Because power is for a purpose. If you're not walking in love, the power of God will flow through you. Hello? You must be compassionate. So when we're talking about witnessing, if you are compassionate, you see somebody going into the wilderness, wasting in his life, something in you will not allow you to ignore him. Say, no, Jesus loves you. Please come back home. Hello? Without compassion, you cannot win soul for Christ. Compassion. Do you have the heart of compassion? Thank you, Jesus Christ. In Luke chapter 12. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 12, verses 16 to 21. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Said, and he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my food. So he got blessed, but he didn't understand the purpose of the blessing. He said, what can I do with this thing? I just have abundant money, you know, just money everywhere. And in verse 18, said, and he said, this will I do. Now he concluded his heart. He said, I will put down my barns and build the greater one. That's why I will just store it. And there I will bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, so thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. See, he has no plan at all to touch other lives. It's all about me, my wife, and my children. He doesn't have any plan to touch any other life. If you are in that category, the power of God cannot flow through you, sir. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
The power of God cannot flow through you if you are a selfish person. Because a selfish man or woman cannot enjoy the power of God. Because power is for a purpose. If it's all about, oh, you know some people, everything is about, bless me. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let me have money. What do I have? Why do you need that money? So that I can buy the latest Mercedes. There's nothing wrong with having the latest Mercedes. But if you ask him, why do you want to have it? Remember my neighbor. He just bought a Toyota. I want to show him. I can go and speak. That's the wrong reason. Hallelujah. I want to show that woman that, I know how to go to Dubai to buy clothes. Yes. Thank God for good cure. It's not just about that. Are you feeling on to others? Consider it. How many people can give a testimony that God has used you to set them up into the place of destiny, in the place of destiny? Are you there to Jesus Christ? So he said, I will say to my soul, thou hast much goods. Laid up for many years. Take. Then eat, drink, and be merry. So his ministry to eat, to drink, and be merry. Nothing more. He said, but God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that lay up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. So if you are thirsting for God's power so that you can use it for selfish reasons, you can't have God power like that. We are talking about unconditional love. Check yourself. How do you feel about people who are disadvantaged? Did you say, let me take advantage of that man? Hallelujah. You know, you might say that when you see somebody who has been pursued by masquerade, you could even go into his house and eat his food. Free food. That is wickedness. You are taking advantage of that person. And as that you are eating his food, curses is following. The Bible said curses in the house of the thief. So don't take advantage of people, sir. He said, there was this man, he said he wanted to buy an aeroplane. He didn't know that this particular woman that wanted to send the aeroplane, the jet. The husband died, you know, and the family is grieving, so they wanted to sell that thing. And when they came up with the price, it was far below the real price. And the other one said, as he was about to write the check, the Lord said, no, don't do that. That is not the right price. Go and find out about the right price and pay this woman the right price. And he said he found out the right price and discovered that the thing was worth more than that. So he paid the right price for that woman. He said, after that, the Lord just opened the windows of heaven upon me. And torrents of blessing started coming. You will have said, this woman is in trouble. Hallelujah. Amen. You will have said, this woman is in trouble. Let me take advantage of her. Don't do that. Be compassionate. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Be compassionate. Say, I'll be compassionate. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Jesus said to Peter, he said, you should finish. Is your sheep. Thank you, Jesus. In John chapter 21. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Verse 15. Let's start from verse 15. It says, so when they had time, Jesus said to Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me more than this? He said unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. You know, if you look at the Bible very well, that's what love. Jesus said, agape, or do you love me with unconditional love? And Peter said, Lord, you know I love you with filial. That is conditional love. That is a friendship kind of love. No, Jesus said, you've not got it. So I'm saying, do you love me unconditionally? In verse 16, he said unto him again, second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Do you love me unconditionally? He said unto me, yea, Lord, I love you as a friend. Ah, Jesus said, feed my sheep. Now in verse 17, he said unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved. So Peter became angry. I said, but Lord, why are you asking me? First and second and third time. Because he said unto him the third time, he said, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. Without love, you cannot feed the sheep. Without love, you cannot love someone. I mean, without the God's kind of love, you cannot appreciate a man that you know is trying to dig you behind. And he's talking evil against you behind. And you say, still pray for him. You say, pray for what? When they say pray for someone, something else, you are praying with fervency. When it comes to the turn of that man, Lord, if you know, help him. If you don't know, you see,
but it takes the love of God. Hello? It's the love of God. You had the news that somebody is a witch and is trying even to bring you down, to make up the family, and you see his son sick in the hospital. You say, God has got him. No. Compassion will move you. You say, no. That was the kind of spirit that was upon Joseph. Joseph had every right to say, arrest them all and cut off their head. But compassion won't let him. The Bible said he entered. He started crying. Still crying. He said, Judah, you led the revolt against him that day. Reuben, bless you. Imagine if he tried to pave way by himself. You know, without compassion, he would never have arrived at the throne. Because he would have been offended in God. He said, God, what are you looking at? And he would have caught himself on the power of God. You know, he interpreted the dream by the power of God. Without the ability to interpret that dream, he would have died in the prison. So when God said, love people unconditionally, so that his grace can flow unto you, sir. So I believe we will thirst for more of his love. Hey, Lord, help me to love you. Help me to love my neighbor. Because, like we say in Nigeria, a red eye cannot light cigarette. A natural man cannot love someone that you know hates you. Someone that you know is going to the boss at job every time and is reporting you. I want to love him. But Jesus said, I've given you the ability to do so. Still love him. Still love him. You know, at a point, he will come to you. He say, you're a different man. Hallelujah to Jesus, right? God gave me one grace one time. Not in my youth service, I was serving, there was a man that was heading the department. I didn't know that he had the same qualification that I had, but he had HND. So when I arrived with PSC, he felt threatened. So he kept on doing all manner of things, but I was not even having the plan to stay in that company after my NYSC thing. But he tried to do all manner of things. In fact, he got the point that he went to NYSC to report me one time. But I never reacted to him. I thought he was doing my doing things normally. And at the end, one day he called me. He said, Femi, you are special. I said, what? He said, despite all the evil that I did unto you, you never paid me back. I just smiled. I said, oh God, everything is fine. It's fine. Don't pay evil for evil, sir. Because it's a seed. Whatever you sow, you will reap. The last one is the purity factor. Purity. Pastor Debo said one time, he said, an anointed
man that is given to anger is a madman in the loose. I mean, roaming about the street.
Because, you know, every one of us, we need his grace. We need a pure life. Because without purity, the power can consume you. You know, if you look at your mirror, if a mirror is clean, every light that goes into it, it reflects everything back. But when it is dirty, it's in trouble. You can't reflect it back. So the cleaner you are, the more is glory that you can reflect. Thank you, Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
In Psalms 45 and verse 6, Psalm 45 verse 6 said, "Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is the right scepter." He said, "Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore, God thy God has anointed thee with the oil of gladness." Because you love righteousness. You love righteousness. You love righteousness. You love righteousness. You see, there are many things that God wants to pass through us. But he can't release it because it's too dangerous. He will destroy us. He will destroy us. Look at Moses, with all his anointing, this same man that divided the Red Sea by the power of God, with all his anointing, went of him. What happened to him?
He lost.
So somebody can say, you know, because we like giving excuses. Oh, but Israel is remain. They were terrible people. They were the one that provoked him. God didn't listen to that. Because of anger, with all his anointing, he did not get to the promised land. Nothing will stop succeed in stopping you from arriving at the promised land of your life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Let's stand up. Purity. I think I should end with this story that my daddy told me one time. He said there was a man who wanted to get married. I mean, he was with his father, he was working hard, doing everything. And one day he went to the father and he said, "Daddy, why are you so wicked?" Daddy said, "Why am I wicked? I'm not wicked." He said, "Look at my age. I'm mature enough to get married. Why don't you marry? Why don't you allow me to go and get married?" And Papa said, "My son, yes. But before you can marry, I want to test your maturity." And he said, "How do we do it?" He said, "Now, we have to buy a pig. And when you buy a pig, you remember that pig can reproduce fast. When the pig reproduces and has many children, we take the small ones to the market and sell. And we are going to use the proceeds or the money from that, from the sale of the pig, to do your wedding." And they say, "Is that why? That is so easy. Now marriage is sweet." So the man went to the shop, bought a pig, and brought it to the man. Said, "Take care of this pig." And this man will go to the bush. "Collect cassava, not chocolate, bring it home." He started feeding the pig. The pig started growing, becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. And he said, "Now, very soon, these kings, I will have many pigs to sell so that I can get married." But the father kept on looking at him. "Is this man really mature?" And one day, the father said to the man, he said, "Well, I've spoken to your in-law, I've been able to get a wife for you. Very soon you are going to get married. But your in-laws will be coming to visit us. So when you get to the farm, bring in more cassava and more yam tuber so that we can have party." Remember, this man was always bringing in cassava from the farm for the pig. And the pig is used to his owner, taking care of him and giving him the cassava. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So this day, the man went to the farm, he brought fresh cassava and fresh yam. He put it on the ground. And the pig, he thought it was for him. So the pig went there and said, "This is my owner's cassava, the cassava that I used to eat." And he started eating it. And you know what? This boy became angry. He said, "The cassava that I was supposed to give my in-law." He brought out his cutlass. Wah! And he cut off the pig. And the father said, "You are not ready for marriage." You see, you are not ready. Because if I allow you to marry now, any day that woman do something,
talking. That's when you will cut off his head. Hello?
God wants to give us his power to change our nation, to change our family. Are we ready?
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are we ready? Let's stand up. Are we ready? Let's begin to give him glory. I say, Lord, thank you for the availability of your power. Thank you for the availability of your power. Thank you for the availability of your power, Lord. I give you praise. I give you glory. I give you honor. I give you adoration. Thank you for your power. 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 Blessed be your name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Like we said, the compassion factor, the God's kind of love must be burning in your heart. And the purity factor. You know, especially when it comes to anger. I was meditating about Moses. You know, unto whom much is given, much is expected. What Moses did that made him to lose out from going to the promised land, many other people did worse thing. Yet, it may seem as God was just looking at them. No. You need to be like Christ. You know, at the point, Jesus was moving with his disciples. And they went to the place, they preached, they didn't receive the gospel. Disciples said, no, let's go fire and consume them. Jesus said, you don't know what you're saying. You don't know the kind of spirit that is in you. You have been preaching to your mommy. You have been preaching to your daddy. You have been preaching to your cousin. And the cousin is not even responding to the gospel. You start cursing him. He's a bad boy. I don't like that boy again. Compassion is the compassion. Compassion that makes you to kneel down all the night. And you wake up all the night and say, Lord, this boy must be saved. This, my mommy, cannot continue in this situation. Lord, cause his eyes of understanding to be enlightened. Lord, he can't die to go to hell. Your neighbor is not nice. But don't watch him go to hell. Don't watch him go to hell. See, Bible said that seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things. As you are seeking the kingdom of God, it will be added. It will be added. Is it clothing? Is it clothing? Is it shirt? No. It will be added. Go after God. Those who go after God don't have to go after things. Things will naturally come. I want us to pray right now. Lord, anything like that song that we sang at the beginning, that will make me not to make heaven. Anything that will make me to depart from the truth. Anything that will make me to depart from serving you. Lord, deliver me in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. God, deliver me. Pray with fervency. Pray with all seriousness. That anything that will not make you to make it in life, anything that will not make you to serve God, anything, any impurity that will not make the power of God to flow in your life, Lord, deliver me. Lord, deliver me. Lord, deliver me. Lord, deliver me. In the name of Jesus Christ. Oh God, deliver me. Deliver me. Pray, brethren. Pray with fervency. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name. Do you know that Judas Iscariot was supposed to be enjoying the best of grace. But iniquity won't allow him. Iniquity will not allow him. The Bible says his bishopric was given to somebody else. Stone will not take your place in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I said, stone will not take your place in the name of Jesus Christ. The truth is that if the power of God is not flowing through you, it's natural when something is not working, we replace it. You know the batteries for the microphone? One is back off, we threw them away. It's not useful. Even that way that when a salt loses its taste, say it's only meant for the donkey. Your destiny will not be abandoned in the donkey in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The destiny of your children will not be abandoned in a donkey in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
No donkey. Trash can. Trash can. It doesn't worth anything.
So it's that man. Just leave it.
But as the Lord leave it, I see the power of God coming upon your life, transforming you into a man to be wondered at in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I speak to your life today. As the Lord leave it, those who are waiting for you to be mocked, they will become the subject of mockery themselves in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
for you to go down the pit. We go down the pit for you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Everyone that has vowed that you will never make it, the anger of God rises up against such fellow in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
The Bible says, as they move from nation to nation, he suffered no one to do them no wrong. He said, saying, touch not my anointed and do my prophet no harm. As the power of God is coming afresh upon you, the ability to enjoy divine enlightenment be released upon you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
This week, they will congratulate you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I said, this week, message of congratulation will be coming in torrent towards you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
You and your children will not be buried in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. You will not receive any negative reports from home in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you will not send any negative report to home in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I speak into your life that the Lord will cause you to laugh in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this message. However, I want to remind you that God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son for the entire world, including you, to be saved from sin and all its consequences. It therefore does not make any sense to spend the next minute of your life without accepting Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. God bless you as you believe and confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior right now. Hallelujah.